Commercial Construction Coffee Talk fans, thanks for chiming in. My name's David Corson. I'm your host. I'm also the publisher and editor of Commercial Construction and Renovation magazine. Hope everybody's staying cool. It's August, the dog days of summer. I'm in the ATL, sizzling hot. It's not raining here today, unbelievable, but really hot and humid. It's just so hot. I play lacrosse on Sunday nights. I think I lose 20 pounds every Sunday night. I got to drink water for a couple of days just to get myself rehydrated. And we play at 6 and 7:15 at night. You know, you think it's cool. The AstroTurf has grabbed all the heat all day and you go out there and you just sweat your tail off. So, and I'm telling you, at 58, I wake up on Monday morning, I'm bruised and beaten up. I'm trying to get out of bed and I'm like, God, it's getting tough every year to get out of bed because I'm all beaten up and I'm dehydrated. So, anyway, last night I'm up late. I'm watching the U.S. polo team, water polo team at the Olympics. No one in the stands. They're playing Spain. Goes in, they lost 12-8. But I was going back and forth. I watched the U.S. women's basketball team. They crushed Australia. So, it was a positive or negative, late night watching at 3 o'clock in the morning, water polo. So, thought the men were going to pull it out there in the water. Nope. Can't win them all. So anyway, hopefully they'll end up in the top six and they're playing in the losers bracket, I think. So anyway, but exciting stuff there. So hard fought game. So kudos to them and congrats to the women's basketball team. Always good with the U.S. I think we're leading in the medals, but not in the gold, but all over we're number one in the medal count. So let's keep it going. Go USA. So everybody, tonight, I have a very interesting gentleman, a jack of all trades. He's up in Rye, New Hampshire. His name is RJ Lincoln, and he's the co-founder of a staffing firm in the maritime industry called ReelHires. RJ, I want you to say hi to our audience out there in Commercial Construction Coffee Talk land.
Hey, how's everybody doing? David, I want to thank you for inviting me here. I'm honored. I've been watching you and your magazine. It is an industry icon and it's always filled with great information. So thanks for having me and I'm glad to be here. Welcome everybody.
Yeah, you know what, RJ, I was on LinkedIn, and I saw your post or whatever. That's how, so I messaged RJ, I left him a voicemail, and he probably go, who the hell's calling me from 404? What the hell area code's that? And we talked, I'm like, come on, man, I see you're doing the co-founding thing, blah, blah, blah. So here you are. And the reason why, as a publisher, I look at subscriptions and circulation and I've just seen since COVID hit, everybody's going this way, started their own business. They've been furloughed. They've been laid off. They're still looking for a job. I mean, it's just been crazy, going in other industries. So, you've been in retail, you've been in the event industry and, now you're in the staffing gig. And I just thought it would be kind of a cool thing to have you on to get a vibe of, the employment situation. Cause just in construction, staffing is so tough to find people to work, with the stupid government putting in the unemployment, half the people don't want to work. You can't, restaurants can't find people to wait or bartend. Construction guys can't find enough project managers, superintendents, or just laborers. It's in, every subcontract. I just did my basement trying to find a painter or a framer or electrician. There was they'll do it for this, get your checkbook out. But hey, I'm all swamped, which is a very positive thing. But it's amazing, it's just crazy, but I still get people sending me resumes and they're all looking. I always ask them, do you want to stay where you lived? Are you willing to move? What are you looking for? And timing your business is everything. You never know when someone's going to pull the trigger. And, some people get hired right away. Some people, don't get hired for, a year or so. And then boom, something really just, falls in the lap. So you got to stay positive out there. So I thought RJ would be a good way now that we're kind of coming in the pandemic. Well, maybe not with the variant Delta, call it whatever the heck it is.
Right.
So if, whatever happens, happens. So, but I thought RJ would be a good person right now to get a vibe of just on the business sector of, you need people to get things done. I don't care what you're doing, whether it's drywall, maritime, teaching school, you need people to get stuff done. So RJ, we kind of do this in three parts.
Sure.
You got to tell your story, which I kind of know anyway, but you got to tell your story. Can't leave anything out to the internet. I can find everything. But tell us your story, where you grew up, kids, married, where you went to school, you know, tell your story. Then we'll talk about, you know, how you got into this, and then we'll finish it up. So with that said, the floor is yours. RJ, tell us your story.
Awesome. Thanks, David. So let me start at the beginning. So I'm probably one of the few people that you'll ever have on your podcast that was born, raised, and continues to live in the same town that he was born in. As a matter of fact, I live 14 houses down the road that I was raised in. So I live in a little town, Rye, New Hampshire. It's, you know, New Hampshire has like 13, 14 miles of coastline, and nice little place. You know, like I said, I've been here. The house that we live in is just down the road from where I grew up as a kid. I bought it in the mid 90s, got married, had a couple of beautiful girls. Career wise, you know, I went to Portsmouth High School, played hockey and football there. I went to Plymouth State College for a very short stint. I grew up working as a teenager. So I was with my father, you know, he was in heavy infrastructure construction, bridge construction. And so he used to tote me along when I was a little kid. And I was probably 16, 17 years old, started working in the construction business, you know, bridges, mainly bridges, but some other infrastructure. Like we did a cement batch plant when I was in my junior year of high school. So I was a worker, you know, and I got used to having a few bucks in my pocket as a high school kid. And graduated, went to Plymouth State and was up there for a year. Wasn't making any money, and I couldn't deal with that. So I left school. I'm not a college guy. So I left school. I went back. I was working construction for a while, had a bad accident, got hit with some swinging steel on a bridge one time. And
ouch.
Got pretty banged up there. I got hit in the face with steel and fell 40 feet into 2 feet of water. And while I was getting healed up, a buddy of mine was in the commercial fish business, and he came to visit me. He's like, dude, if you're gonna like risk your neck, why don't you come fishing, make some real money, you know? So I started fishing. And at this time I was in my early 20s, fished in the Gulf of Maine for a few years. At that time is when they just started factory fishing in the Barents Sea in Alaska. And I was reading about this in the trade rags, and I was really intrigued, and there was nothing holding me in New England. So I'm like, I'm gonna go out there and check this out. So I know you're an outdoorsman, so you might get a kick out of this story. So I went out there, I got on a 265-foot factory boat with 46 people. I was a deck boss. So just to put things in perspective, I was on a high-line boat in Boston. We used to catch about 800,000, 900,000 pounds of groundfish a year.
Oh, wow.
And when I went to Alaska, the first 15 days on that boat, we brought aboard 13 million pounds of Pacific pollock. So we process them right on the boat, and we would come in about every 15 days, we'd come into Dutch Harbor with about 450 metric tons of fillets.
Unload it,
take on 100,000 gallons of fuel, two box tractor trailer truck loads of groceries, and go back out and do it again. So that was a wild experience. And I loved the fish business, but you know, going back to met my wife, settling down, getting married, I'm like, I can't really be at sea for 6 months at a time. So got a real job. So I got into finance for a little while. I spent a few years, about 3, 4, 5 years at Prudential and Fidelity. And then from there, I took a right turn, got in the events business, did that for that one company for about 3 years, and then another company for about 15 years. And then decided to make another change. I went to work for JLL. I worked with them for just shy of a couple of years. And you know, with the pandemic and everything, you know, just, I'm like, I want to do something else. Like half the country is, I mean, you know, I don't know if you heard, but it came out July 9th of this year on CNBC that 4 million people quit their job in April. That's 7% of the workforce just up and quit their job. And the reason being is just because of what's going on with the, with COVID, and, you know, people were just kind of reevaluating life, you know, do I want to sit in a box and spend the next 10, 20 years? And so, you know, I think a lot of people, at least half the people in the country, are reevaluating what they're going to do with their future. So I was thinking about starting my own business, and I was working with a consultant, and she's in the UK. And the more we worked together, the more we started talking about this, and we decided to join forces and focus on the Maritimes, just because the Maritimes has always been underserved in staffing, but also with all the new technologies that are coming out, you know, with air, with wind, you know, so all these offshore wind farms is going to really start to grow. And with all the technologies that we're all hear about that are also now getting into the Maritimes, you know, artificial intelligence, robotics, autonomous vehicles, they're actually building autonomous ships in Scandinavia right now. We decided to go for that. So we launched, you know, launched the business in March, and it's just been really great. Some people tell me, you know, you guys are crazy with all the craziness going on with the workforce and with COVID and the pandemic and all that. But the thing that we're seeing is that we're on the backside of a wave that's building, you know, with all of this movement and all of this craziness that's going on in the world and in the workforce. We're starting to see some really great things. So eventually this, we know eventually, I hope, unless the world comes to an end, that, you know, this will all shake out, this will come to an end. And, we'll do well. But, you know, the thing that you mentioned that you saw online is kind of crazy. It's the change in the work, you know, in the way we work, right? So the thing that you saw was talking about, you know, in the past, everybody worked 9 to 5. In the future, people are going to work anytime, all the time, anytime, whenever they want. You know, they're talking about, you know, working in a corporate office, where the new norm will be working anywhere. You know, it talks about using company equipment, focused on input. You know, the new world will be, you know, working on any device, focused on output as opposed to focused on input. So there's a lot of things that are changing and actually kind of turning around 180, you know, where we're talking about, you know, people always were focused on climbing the corporate ladder. Now people are going to create their own ladder. You know, predefined work, where now we're talking about customized work. Even the stuff that my partner and I are working on is really amazing. So we have currently, we have 4 employees that are focused in the UK, Atlanta, New Hampshire, and Boston. So they're all over the place. We meet regularly, just like you did in the office. You know, we Zoom regularly, we have our team meetings, and it's a very rewarding situation. One of the things that we're seeing, you know, since we've been doing this and with all this change, and part of the reason that 4 million people quit their job in April is, you know, they're looking at what's going on in the world, and they're planning on looking for new jobs that will focus more on increased compensation, work-life balance, you know, better growth opportunities within an organization. So there's a lot going on, and it's just, you know, it's really exciting. I was at a job fair today, and there's a, you know, it has its pluses and minuses. There were 33 companies there looking to hire people, and they only had about 28 people come through looking for jobs. So, you know, there's the way I look at it and the way that I talk to people is, you know, it's like everything we do, right? And everything we work on, you can look at the glass half empty, or you can look at the glass half full. So some of the people that are looking at the glass half empty, they're looking at it old school. And that is, I want people here, you know, 8 hours a day. They're going to do it my way. They're going to do it this way. And on the other side, though, there are companies, and there's actually one just before we jumped on. There was a local HVAC company that has a TV advertisement that has a guy saying, you know, this company is a great company. They offered me, you know, the opportunity to watch my kids grow up. I can coach my son play basketball or hockey, and, you know, and I can watch my family grow up, spend more time with them. And so, you know, this is a forward thinking new company where they're like, we have to offer employees a good work-life balance, a good wage for the trades that they're working in, and an opportunity to grow within the organization. So those people are looking at it right. And we're seeing more and more of those companies that are starting to get this. I mean, I've worked in the past with companies that, you know, we had a work structure, we had our team, we were focused on the culture of the company. And so we felt that everybody had to be here every day because they had to get ingrained in the culture. We wanted to develop a family/team environment. And, you know, a lot of people would come in and they'd be like, you know, I'm an hour and a half away. Is there any way that I could work from home a couple of days a week or whatever? And there was very little flexibility then. But, you know, the thing that we're seeing now, and I've seen with a lot of the companies that I'm working with, is that when you allow people and you give them the responsibility to do the work that they need to work on their own terms, work from home, we're seeing with a lot of companies that the output that people are putting out
is a lot.
It's much better, right? Because, you know, they've got a great work-life balance. You know, they don't have to sit in front of a computer in a box for 8 to 10 hours. They can do 4 or 5 hours of work. You know, they can go to their kid's game or they can go out with their wife to dinner or lunch or whatever. And then they come back and they grind out another 4 or 5 hours of work. So these employers, a lot of these employers that are getting on the early bandwagon of implementing these work-life balance environments are starting to see more productivity out of their employees.
That was the most interesting conversations. We went when last year I did my summit in January. I did my one CCRP down at Cocoa Grove. And then I was in Milwaukee looking at hotels for my retreats. And Tom Hanks got the bug and they canceled March Madness and everything else. Everything got canceled. And we came back and I hate using the word pivot, but we pivoted. I was basically a print face-to-face guy. And then all of a sudden I went digital. All my face-to-face events were frozen, you know, and I just had to make a decision. But I was going to do this podcast once a month. Then I went weekly. So every week I was talking to contractors, engineers, whatever they were doing. The biggest thing I heard was, oh, we were so worried about our corporate culture. And, you know, and all I heard was, oh, the meetings that took an hour now take 15 minutes. I don't have to have my crew go through rush hour, burn gas, that mental mind and grind. They're working at the house. They can have their dog there. They get to see their kids. They're more productive. And do I need all this space to house them all? If I want to have a meeting, I can go rent a room at a hotel or a conference center or whatever. Zoom. I did a podcast with a guy. He said he was in Bahrain, the UK, South Africa, Latin America, Canada, 2 walkthroughs in the United States, all in one day. Pre-COVID, that would have taken him 2 weeks to do and umpteen million miles on it. And he did all that in one day. So now a lot of the companies have embraced technology and letting their employees and looking overhead and all those other things. Now it's like, okay, I can still keep my company culture. My people are happy. They're going to be more productive. I can grow my business you're in staffing. So as a publisher, I look at circulation cards, people reach out to me. Hey, and I'll say, well, do you want to stay in your city? Are you mobile? But now with Zoom and everything else, you don't have to, you can stay or you can move. That's your prerogative. My son, he went to FAA mechanics school. He graduated in December. So he's studying for his AMP. Which is airframe and powertrain. And anyway, just got hired by Delta yesterday. So he's going to be a contractor for 6 months. And if he does a good job, they're going to put him on with benefits and everything else. But he still has to get his license because he's worth that much more money with his AMP. And but he'll probably be on the graveyard shift. I've told Ben, I'm like, dude, man, you might be doing all day, you know, so just get ready. Because, you know, and if they tell you to pick up the broom and start sweeping the plant wherever they're doing work, that's what you're going to do. You're going to start at the bottom, dude. You know, and right. you're not the president. You got an in. So, he's one of the few that wants to work with his hands. A lot of the kids these days, you know, hey, and they want to push buttons and sit in a cube, you know, or whatever, sit in the basement. You know, yeah. My kid wants to work with the hands. So he did his interview online. Twice they hired him online, they haven't even met him in person, and now you know he's going down and he'll do his paperwork and you know so but you know, without people you can't get anything done. I don't care if it's fishing, I don't care if it's and I you and I are comfortable saying I'm a hockey guy. I went to hockey camp every summer. I come from a military family in construction. I had one all the grandsons everybody, when they got their license outside of Philly at 16, you had to go into the scrap yard. I shoveled asbestos, I put in railroad ties, acetylene torches. I did all that stuff, you know? And so, you know, it was just, you know, the same thing. I was always on the, in with, you know, go down to the scrap yard with my grandfather. And so, you know, that whole ingrained thing. I mean, I still have my erector set when I was, nice. My metal erector set. People laughed, they're like, what's an erector set? I'm like, right. Okay, it's like a metal Lego kit, you know?
Exactly.
You know? But, you know, I just, I was always good with models and, you know, all that stuff. So it, it anyway, but.
Well, one of the things, congratulations on your son and congratulations to you, you know,
yeah, that's so amazing. When you're, if you're on Delta and you see some guy with his American flag, it says Brody Corson on there and he's walking down, you said, you know, you're in good hands.
There okay? you go. I'll say hi to him. But, you know, that, like you just said, you know, if you don't have the workforce and you don't have the staff, you're in trouble. So one of the things we've all seen and you've seen over your career, you know, in with the Commercial Construction Magazine in your events, and I've seen over the last 20 years, is it has continually, you know, corporate America has continually evolved and focused more and more on the stockholders and less on the employees. Whereas there's a paradigm now where that's turning, where the companies, the employers, they have to start focusing more on their employees, because if they don't, forget the shareholders. I mean, if they don't get the output from the employees, they're not going to have any profits to share with the shareholders. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you've got to, the companies are starting to focus more and more on their employees. I was just at a job fair earlier today where for tradesmen, you know, it was Bath Ironworks up in, you know, Bath, Maine, and they actually have relocation assistance for tradesmen, carpenters, you know, pipe fitters, welders, scaffold builders, sandblasters. That's not a lot. You never heard about that before. They're paying relocation assistance, because that's another thing is we're starting to see people are moving, you know, they're moving around. I mean, the town that I live in, a little seaside community, the real estate values here have gone through the roof. I mean, people from New York, Connecticut, Rhode Island, they're coming to Rye and they're paying $60,000, $80,000, $100,000 over the asking price. In many cases, cash with no inspections, no contingencies, no appraisals, just I'll take it for $1,600. I had a guy recently, you know, I've been dabbling in real estate, and I had a situation recently where a guy came into town, he wanted this house. He just told his realtor, go to the selling realtor and tell the guy I'll pay $100,000 more than the highest bid he gets. No cash. I mean, no contingencies, no inspections. I'm like, where do these people come from?
Well, listen, I'm in Atlanta and we bought a piece of land last September and I had my house in the market and my office was down there and it was all stubbed out, but the we lived here 17 years. So it was also so we took it off the market, election, January, blah, blah, blah. And then we asked as our own kind, we did the basement, 2,200 square feet, you know. Anyway, we needed another house to live in while we were going to build our house on the lake, kind of our empty nester house. And so it took me 2 months to find the house. Every house I've been on, I was going up against 50 people. And everything, and if you had a mortgage, you weren't even looked at. You had to pay cash. And so the weeks are rolling by, people are looking at the house. And I told my wife, I'm like, look, we got to find a house. You know, we got to get this house, you know, and I was, my last house, we just spent over asking price. And, but I didn't even know where the other 49 people were going to go. And I know the people that sold the house, they moved in with their parents because I don't know where they were going to move because there's no homes for sale. There's right. no inventory. And, it's insane. And, it was an eye opener. I told her, I'm like, look, we're gonna live in a tent, you know, or you know, and we wanted to be close to our land so we could keep an eye on things. We would be our contractor and build and so it I've never seen anything like it. My wife, we lay in bed under contract, pending, under everything, sight unseen. You'd have to have a pocket listing to find a house, right. You know, it hasn't stopped. So. You go in and you try, you have 15 minutes to walk in the house and you walk out and there's three other people waiting to get inside the house. Right. You know, or we've had 40 bids. We don't need anybody else to look at it. I used to just laugh. I'm like, what happened? Did they not build any houses in the last, you know, 8 months or a year? Right. And so it's been eye opening to say the least. And but a lot of people, like you said, that they've pulled up, they've changed, they took a reevaluation of, hey, do I want all the stress or do I want to do something else? Do I want to get a franchisee? I've had several people on my podcast teach people, hey, you, instead of using your 401k, you can take that money, become a franchisee, keep your job, start something else new. There's so many different things that are out there that, you know, even if you might be up in, you know, you're a little older, it doesn't mean that, you know, you can't do something new. And I always tell people, if you're not happy, don't stay there, go do something else. And the day you stop learning, you better go do something else, because, right, you know, it, you know, myself, as long as I don't get arthritis, or I go, I'll probably keep this, but, you know, I don't know, you know.
Right. It's funny, you know, this, you just made me think, there's a small contingency, just local people, that because now you can basically go wherever you want to work. I've got a bunch of buddies of mine, they're all buying these Sprinter vans and they're outfitting them. So they're just hopping in the van with their wife and they're driving across the country and they're getting their work done. You know, they've got, as long as you've got a connection,
yeah,
they're seeing the country and they're getting their job done at the same time, you know. So they're, you know, and I think that's what a lot of people are looking for in this new workforce economy, is that people are trying to, you know, earn a living, but they want to live life at the same time, you know. So it's getting the best of both worlds, really. And again, like I said, you know, there are a lot of, I've had a lot in the last couple of months, great conversations with companies that are getting it, you know. They're like, they realize they got to pay a little bit more money. They got to be flexible as far as their, you know, how they let people work. And, you know, they've got to be an opportunity. I mean, that's one of the great things about this little company we've started, is that, you know, we're giving people ownership of what, you know, we're telling them, we want to know what your thoughts are. What direction do you think we should go? What should we be looking at? And, you know, people want that. They want to know that, you know, that you value them, you know, you value in the work that they're doing for you. And it doesn't always come down to money. I mean, that's one of the things in the reports I'm reading, that people are looking for more money. But, you know, there are other things you can do for people. You know, people just want to feel appreciated and cared about, you know. And so there's a lot of things. And like I said, the companies and the people that are looking at this new era as the glass half full, there's a lot of people and a lot of companies are really going to excel over the next 5 to 10 years.
There are 9 million plus jobs available in the United States, and there's only 7 million people that are out of work. There are more jobs available than there are people to work for them, you know. Right. That's happened in my lifetime.
Right. Well, one of the things that came up today by a couple of people, I was talking to a guy in workforce development in Maine, and he was saying, we're hopeful that things are really going to change after September, because what we need is, we need to have all this federal money that they're passing out to dry up, because nobody's going to, you know, a lot of these people aren't going to go back to work. In many cases, we all know people that are making more money sitting home watching TV than they were at their job. They're like, why would I go back to work?
Yeah.
So once that money dries up, you know, they're thinking that after September, you'll see a lot more people entering the workforce, which will be a good thing.
When the states opened up, you know, not all the country opened up, but like, you know, when certain states opened up, people are like, hey, you can go to the bar, but I'm going to get any service because there's no bartenders, or there's no waitresses, or your food's going to take forever. There's not enough cooks back there. You know, I go down the list and, you know, I just laugh. And, but, you know, my son, he was a waiter. He got laid off. He got unemployment. I said, take it, you know, and, you know, he took it, but he was still going, you know, going to school, you know, and he graduated. But it was insane. His market, there's 600,000 maintenance guys that are going to retire because they've been there doing it for, like, you know, so there's going to be a shortage of, you know, maintenance guys. And the planes, you know, in the airline industry, you can't let your airplane sit on the tarmac. It has to be maintained. So it's, you know, it's like a car. You got to drive it to make sure that the fluids and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, and the biggest thing is that once he gets his AMP license, he can walk anything that has a jet engine working. He could be in a healthcare facility. He can be on a train. He could be on an airline. He could, you know, maybe doesn't even use it. You get so many people, they get their law license and they become a politician or they become something else. So,
right.
I mean, look at me, I'm a publisher, you know, we have a federal contracting company, you know, I mean, doing poison ivy and kudzu. So it's we're with my wife, you know, I'm kind of behind the scenes, but you know, and I'm a publisher too. So it's interesting. And, it's amazing to see though, you know, what happens is like, you know, you're in retail, so you'll understand this, that a lot of the people that were furloughed or laid off on the brand side, they always try to go over to the vendor side, but then they see how they treated people. And and anybody out there in commercial construction, coffee talk, you know what I'm talking about here. So come on, be real. You know what I'm talking about. So, but they see how they were treated on the other side. So when they go back to the end user or the building owner side, they're a lot nicer, you know, to the vendors, you know, because they see that, you know, they hold the keys to the money and the cash and all that. And you very rarely see the vendor go over to the end user side. It's always the other way, but they always end it back. But it's amazing to see how many people that have actually started their own businesses that I've known that have been, you know, VPs of construction for, you know, umpteen million brands. And now they've done their own gig and they're, you know, being an entrepreneur, the captain, you know, you go down with the ship, you don't want your ship to sink, you know, so
right.
From a maritime point of view. And, but every day is an ordeal. You know, you go on the ocean, the business is very vicious. So the ocean can turn in a second. You can be in a storm, you know, the perfect, you know, George Clooney, the perfect storm, all that. So, you know, I had this guy once, he said, you know, I'm talking construction here, you know, construction in the life of a building, you know, if it's your finger, you know, your whole finger, construction is only like the tip of it. After that, it's facilities and all this other stuff. My life keeps going out, but you know, it's only a little bit of it. So a lot of firms, you know, will they hire a contractor? No, they might do a project manager. They might not someone on the books. They'll have, you know, so there's so many opportunities that are out there right now that have been created, you know, from COVID. And, you know, I had an office. I had everybody come in. If I had to do it over again, when I started my company back in 2001, I would have everybody work out of their house. Now, right. You know, I used to do it with 14 people. Now I do it with 5, you know, or 4. I forget what it is, you know? So, right. I mean,
Well, it's, you know, it's funny going back to like what your son's doing, which is, you know, my hat's off to him. That's awesome. He's going to do very well. But, you know, we're in a situation right now where so many college kids, even one of mine, have got thrown a curveball by this COVID thing. And now they're all discombobulated. Like, what am I doing? Am I doing the right thing? You know, and a buddy of mine just recently started a charity called Bring Back the Trades. And his thing is, why would you go put a kid $60,000, $80,000, $120,000 in debt and go out and make, you know, starting out making $60,000, $80,000, $100,000 a year when you could, I mean, plumbers are making 120, you know, 200 bucks an hour. And, you know, it costs you a couple $1,000 to go out and get licensed. Then you got to get some work experience and bang, you're off and running, making a handsome income. And it's a satisfying job, you know, where you're helping a lot of homeowners or businesses or whatever it is, you know, take care of whatever it is, plumbing, electrical, carpentry, you know, the
gamut. I tell you had shop class, right?
Yeah,
it was like one of my favorite things to do. I remember when we, this is how the combustion engine and, you know, some guys were the gas, some guys were the pistons and we're walking through and, you know, they need to bring all that back. And,
right.
You know, I knew my son wasn't, listen, he'll be the first one to tell you, he wasn't college material. He couldn't stand school.
Yeah.
He couldn't stand it. He wanted to work with his hands. First, he wanted to be a motorcycle tech. Then he wanted to be a car tech. I said, look, you got to have your own shop to make money, you know? And then he saw the airplane thing and we went and he went through it. And I said, look, you know, you get your license, you get your pilot's license, or even, you know, worth that much more. But the bottom line is you got to work your tail off. You know, nothing's easy. And, you know, all his friends, they all went to school, 4 years degree, get their bachelor of liberal arts or whatever. And I told him, I said, look, dude, you're going to be out of school in 2 years. You're going to be 21. You're going to be worth big bucks. You could go join the army, do your 4 years and be 25, see the world and still have your license. And then, you know, go back to school if you wanted to, you could do that. And so it was, you know, it was interesting to see him go through it. And let me tell you, I looked at some of the curriculum that he was taking. I mean, this was serious stuff, man. We get into avionics and, you know, all that stuff. And I'm looking at, you know, this stuff. And my dad was a pilot. So I was pro, you know, I was psyched that he went that route. But, you know, it, but half the people that started the class with him, they dropped out, you know? And so, you know, I just said, look, man, whenever the airline's coming, you be the first guy in that front row. You make sure that you grab his car and you make sure you get that and you keep it online, because it's all who you know, and timing of business is everything, where you want to be, who you're going to know, who you're going to talk to. And that's why, you know, when people send me, hey, do you know anybody that's looking for this? Or, you know, hey, can I send you my resume? Look, send me the resume, because I can send it out or I can keep it on file. And, you know, you never know. And right now, everybody's looking for everybody, you know? So, I mean, I'm not familiar with that much with maritime, but I'm sure it's just like everybody else. Everybody's looking for someone.
It is. You know, I mean, that's one of the differentiators we have is we've built a database a lot. We've got over 500,000 CVs or resumes with people that are affiliated with the Maritimes, and also in their, they've stated that they're open to hearing about new opportunities. So, you know, we've got tons of people looking. But it's funny, in your business, and even when I was in the events business, you know, I used to say early on, I'm like, wow, I mean, I know we can't start a staffing firm because it would kind of cannibalize the business, but we had people reaching out to us all the time, and I would help people just, you know, like you, I'm like the help it kind of, I mean, I just love helping people, you know, I mean, and I'm a big believer in what goes around comes around, you know? So when you help somebody and help them, you know, get a new opportunity, or help a company that calls and ask if we know a guy that does this or does that, you know, it's just helping the industry. It's helping each other. It's a big, you know, what goes around comes around, you know, and right. I've had opportunities before where I've had needs and I've called, reached out to people and they've been there for me. You know, it's just great. You know, the industries that you serve are just filled with amazing quality, you know, sincere people, you know, and I just really like that. When I was younger and worked in the technology field before the bubble burst, you know, there was a lot of people riding around on their, you know, high horses, but, you know, I just love retail. I love healthcare. I love hospitality. They're just real honest, good people.
So RJ, if you wanted to leave our audience out there in commercial construction coffee talk land, one phrase or positive thought, what would it be coming out of the pandemic?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. And I think the thing that I would leave them with that I've mentioned a couple times while we've been talking is, you know, whatever's going on right now, whether it's in your business or you're an employer and you're looking for new opportunities, just think positively, because there's a lot of change going on right now, which is going to create a ton of opportunity for both candidates and for employers. So just keep a positive attitude. A lot of us don't like change, but, you know, a lot of good can come out of change. So just stay positive. Stay focused, you know, continue to be, you know, loyal and empathetic and understanding with your employers and candidates, you know, be understanding with the people you're talking to about going to work with them. But, you know, there's a lot of good that's going to come out of this. And as much negativity as we hear in the press and in the news, you know, if you stay positive, it'll work out for the best for everybody, both employers and candidates alike.
As a hockey guy, you'll appreciate it. I try to tell people, hey, look, got to keep your head up, because there's some big boys out there looking for to clean your hand. And if you don't shoot, you can't score. So take as many shots as you can, because eventually it's a numbers game. Sometimes that biscuit's going to go in. Sometimes it won't. It might hit the pipe sometimes. You just don't know.
Right. So, exactly.
RJ, if someone wanted to get in touch with you, even if they were in the maritime and, you know, they wanted to, you know, hey, can you help me? How would they reach out to you?
Yeah, no, I appreciate that, David. And, you know, we have a lot of crossover in our past and everything. But the name of the company is ReelHires.com, R-E-E-L, a little play on the maritime. So ReelHires.com. My email address is rj@ReelHires.com. And feel free. A lot of old friends are going to hear this probably. And feel free to give me a call. You can call me on my cell, 603-380-6911.
If anybody wants to reach out to me, if you have any cool projects or any of that stuff, we look at everything. I'm at davidc@ccr-mag.com. If you're not a subscriber, up on my homepage, there's a button that says subscribe. Click on it. We send the magazine out to 125,000 people. In fact, RJ, I have a guy, one of your PMs that's up in Nashville that did the Sylvan Supply redevelopment that's on my cover coming up next week.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, and a really, really cool project. You know, it's a reuse. And anyway, I just got the pictures and the answer. So JLL is going to be on the cover of the next issue. So anyway, cool. I think I'm pretty good to throw that shit. And it's like everybody out there, you know, look, if you see, if you have something cool, I've got, it might not make the magazine, but I've got, you know, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, I post stuff every night. We'll find something. It's like playing the lottery. You don't buy a ticket, you can't win. You don't send me something, I can't print it or post it or look at it. So, and you never know what might end up in ink. So send it to me. We're looking for stuff. With that said, RJ, pleasure having you on Commercial Construction Coffee Talk. Thanks for taking my call and messaging me back. And good luck with, being on the sea, staying what you love. And, stay cool the rest of the summer up, because winter's coming soon, you know?
Yeah. Hey, David, thanks again. I appreciate it. It's been an honor being with you this evening. I hope everybody that listens in enjoys it. And I continue to wish you great success in the future.
All right. I appreciate it. So everybody out there in Commercial Construction Coffee Talk land, I'm signing off from Suwanee, Georgia, just below the Buford Dam by Lake Lanier, about 25 miles out of northeast Atlanta. And RJ, say goodnight from Rye, New Hampshire on the coast.
See you later, everybody.
14 miles of sea, a coast on the New Hampshire border. Oh, boy.
We're living large here in Rye. Have a good evening.
Yeah, living on there, Rye. All right, everybody. Listen, enjoy the rest of the summer. Stay cool. Remember, wash your hands. Don't touch your face. And keep your surroundings. And you're going to be okay. RJ, awesome seeing you. I'll tell everybody you said hello. And everybody out there in CCT land, we will see you next time on our next episode of Commercial Construction Coffee Talk. Signing off. See you, RJ.
Take care. Have a good evening.
All right, man.